Howdy there, mi amigos, and thanks again for joining us here on Expanded Perspectives. I'm Cam Hale. As always, joining me today, me good friend here, Mr. Filio, Kyle Filson.
How's it going, everybody? I'm so glad to be back. Sorry we missed last week. It was an unfortunate event. Elite members already know about it. But my wife's grandmother passed away. And with the viewing and the funeral and just consoling loved ones and it being Mother's Day weekend, I just didn't have any time to get with Cam to put out a show. And so we just decided, hey, look, we haven't missed a show in 2.5 years. So we just said, look, rather than mail show in, let's just take a week off, regroup. And so that's where we were at. Like Cam was talking a bit to me about it before the show. If you're ever wondering if there's a problem with the show or there's anything happening, just find us on Facebook. That's where we post our news. We're not going to mess up our website by putting articles and stuff on there, you know, every second of what we're doing. So just go to Facebook.
And if it's easiest, yeah.
Yeah, that's where we're at. But anyways, we're back. Let's get on with the show.
Yeah, that's right. Thanks for everybody for bearing with us. But yeah, we're going to kick the tires and light the fires. We've missed out on a week of fun, a week of madness. So let's do this,
bro. Yeah, doesn't it feel like it's been forever?
It does. Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, we released the Elite Show, but it does. It still feels like it's been forever. And we've got some fun stuff to talk about. Kyle's going to bring up some really cool stuff in the main. But Philly, hook me up. What was this? This is some madness.
This is pretty crazy. I just saw this recently where somebody sent it to me about an abandoned oil tanker that washed up on the shores of Liberia.
First of all, that's the last place you want to wash up.
You couldn't be more right.
Watch the documentary on Vice.
If you're going to wash up on the coast of somewhere, I'm talking anywhere, Liberia is probably the last place you want to do. First of all, the beach would be covered in human feces,
just right? Defecation pot. That's a real landmine you don't want to step in.
Yeah, now if people are like, what are they talking about? Go watch the documentary on Vice about Liberia.
About Liberia.
King, what was his name? Captain Butt Naked.
Is that where he's from? Yeah, I think it is.
That was the names of these guys. Yeah. One was like Mosquito Spray.
One was Mosquito. One was Mosquito Spray. Yeah.
It's madness.
Oh, it's insanity.
Well, anyways, they said the name of the ship was the Tamaya 1, and it's registered in Panama. And it ran aground on a beach near Robertsport earlier this week, apparently without any crew or lifeboats on it. And they said that the Liberia National Police and Bureau of Immigration inspected the ship days after local residents first discovered it on the beach. They said that it's a 200-foot-long tanker, and its last known position was on the 21st of April near Gambia and Senegal. Now, it went off the map. Somehow they couldn't find it, I guess. And then all of a sudden, boom, it shows up here. There's nobody on it. So, of course, all these stories start raising, you know, what happened to the crew, you know, where they, you know, you've seen all these horror movies where they were turned into vampires or something. But more than likely, they said that they probably ran out of money or something and they just jumped ship in their lifeboats and just abandoned it. Yeah. Now, they also, the most interesting thing to me is the Liberian National Police. Did you even know that they had police?
I don't believe that for a minute after seeing that.
Right? Because if you watch any of the videos or the documentaries about Liberia, it's complete madness. No one is running that country, right?
No.
What's scary is the United States actually set up that country.
Yes.
Isn't like the name of the capital, like George Washington City or something? I don't remember all the details. But anyways, they say that they think most likely that the vessel's owner might have gone broke and had no money to pay his crew members. And so they just left it there. And of course, it washed up. What's also odd is they said it was on the beach for a couple days before the authorities ever went and checked it out. And so, like, you know, how do you miss a giant tanker like that on the beach? Why wouldn't they check it out? And they also, people have said that they think it could be pirates that might have taken it. But they said a lot of the pirating isn't going after oil tankers because there's the price of oil and there's nothing they can really do with it.
Yeah.
They usually hijack or pirate, you know, ships that have goods on it.
Yeah.
That they can bring back to shore.
Connex boxes loaded down with stuff.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, look, I don't know. I guess it's different over there, but I wonder if it's the same thing as if it's abandoned, you know, like a maritime law, or if that's only if it's afloat. If it comes aground, you get to keep it. You know, I don't know. There's a whole bunch of stuff of who would have found it, but yeah, I'm sure it's going to be parted out and scrapped out, and who knows what's going to happen to that thing over there. Hey, I got something interesting for you folks, and me and Kyle have talked about it, and I dropped this. It's fun to keep up with a story. It's fun to find these stories and to kind of keep a tab on them as we go. And we always, you know, like I say, when we find an interesting one, we always try to keep an eye out for it. And sometimes you don't really hear any more else about it. This one here, though, has really caused a stir. And it seems to be continually changing, like weekly almost, ever since we've discussed it. And what I'm talking about is the tombs, these hidden tombs that were supposed to be in Tutankhamun's his chamber in there, these other hidden chambers,
right,
in his tomb, and it's changed so much. First of all, it wasn't. The National Geographic went and looked, and it was, and all this. This is actually from Live Science. The headline reads, Nefertiti still missing, King Tut's tomb shows no hidden chambers. It goes on to say that there were some radar scans, of course, conducted by the National Geographic team that we had talked about before, and that they found that there were no hidden chambers in the tomb at all, and it's disproving the claim that there was this secret grave. Now, Dean Goodman is a geophysicist at the GPR Slice Software. Now, he told National Geographic News this: if we have a void, we should have a strong reflection. And that's what he had talked about. He said, but it published on the feature research, but the void, he said, it just didn't exist. It doesn't exist. It's not there. So Life Science gets a hold of Goodman about the research, and then he goes on talking about, be prepared, you know, this non-disclosure agreement that he has this prepared response, so he can't really talk about it. Well, instantly you're kind of like, wait, a non-disclosure agreement? And he says he had it with the National Geographic Society. Well, I'm like, wait a second. You found all this for National Geographic Society, but you can't talk about it through a non-disclosure. I'm like, that's kind of strange. So you go in, and of course, there's some Egyptologists that go and looking in it, and they claim, you know, that last year they found this Tutankhamun doorway, this hidden doorway that was allegedly had led to the tomb of Queen Nefertiti, which is the stepmother of Tutankhamun. Well, these scans are carried out by this fella named Hirakasu Wanatabi, and he claims that it had showed two chambers, evidence of it, had some metal and organic artifacts through these things. We've all discussed this. We talked about these images and all this. Well, Egypt's antiquity minister refused to accept these new results, and he told Live Science that it plans more tests to search the tomb, because what he's talking about is that after National Geographic ran it and said that there was none, the ministry said, wait a second, and this is what it said. The ministry actually is quoted saying, other types of radar and remote sensing techniques will be applied in the next stage. Once they are determined, we shall publish the updates. So right off the bat, it's released that there's these spots. National Geographic Society goes over, they scan it, they say there's not. Antiquities Ministry, they go crazy, and they're like, y'all are wrong.
Right.
You know, it's not real. Well, then, of course, Zahi Hawass, he chimes in. You know, of course, this is the former ministry there of antiquities there in Egypt. He chimes in. This is what he says. If there is any masonry or partition wall, the radar signal should show an image. Now, that's what he said. Now, that was what he said to National Geographic.
Right.
He said, we don't have this, which means there is nothing there. So they go into somebody else, a fellow named Lawrence Conyers. Now, Lawrence is the professor at the University of Denver, and he wrote a book on ground-penetrating radar in archaeology. And this is what he actually says. All I know is that I'm happy I didn't fly halfway around the world to get mixed up in this mess, is what he's talking about, because he actually sent this in an email that he added that he was disappointed that it's not being released, that this information's not coming out more. He says, so I guess that they're going to try other geophysical methods. I am not at all sure what these might be. They use the most obvious ones, which is GPR, ground penetrating radar. The others are much less definitive than GPR. So I suspect that this is just blowing smoke. So that got me to look, and I'm like, what the heck? So even the main guys are like, I didn't go, but now it's kind of funny.
This came out very confusing.
Very confusing. So this was a week ago, mind you. All right, this went down a week ago. Just in the last couple of days, The Guardian releases this: Egypt suppressing truth over hidden chambers in Tutankhamun's tomb. So they talk about the same thing. They talk about the announcement. They talk about their 90% positive that there was a scan of this tombs and all this. Richard Reeve, which is the fellow that found that, he's the British Egyptologist. He was the man that thought he had found the tomb and all this stuff through all this. Well, it says that a second scan, of course, like we just discussed, was carried out by the National Geographic Society. However, the ministry has not revealed the findings. So the ministry, the Egyptian ministry, wouldn't reveal it. It says that it's raising suspicions that they disapproved the original claim and triggering political infighting in Cairo. Now, Dean Goodman is a California-based geophysicist. We talked about it. Now, he analyzed all the data, but he's unable to comment due to a non-disclosure agreement with National Geographic Society. That's just rubbing me raw. That's just, something's not right. Now, like we talked about in the last article, Dean said, I can't talk. They're still talking about this. I can't say anything about it.
Well, you know what that means. I mean, that means that they have seen something, and they're covering it up is what it sounds like to me.
If there was nothing there, why wouldn't you just go, dude, there is nothing there?
Because we thought, right? We theorized that this might happen weeks ago when we first brought the story up. If they ever found anything, do you think they would let the public know? Remember me and you specifically saying no.
No.
That they would probably try to sell it to private collectors or something like that. Unfortunately, it sounds like they found something and they're trying to actively cover it up. Because it's like you're saying, why wouldn't they respond? Not only that, then email, what'd you say, got sent back or something?
Yeah. They emailed. Well, even this, National Geographic, there's a spokeswoman for them, and she actually said that National Geographic scans and Goodman's review of them were shared with the Egyptian Ministry of Antiquities. Any question about the scan results should be directed to the ministry. So National Geographic isn't. So if they're not willing to say what they did, why are they one trying to silence the other? Is it really not there? Because there's something that they lead into with this whole article. What it leads into is... This is funny. There said it doesn't give the fella's name. It just says a scientist familiar with controversy. This is what he says. My understanding is that the Egyptians are in a state of denial about this. They're freaking out and it has become politically toxic. When you're in the middle of a situation in which people are being purged because of their position on this, then scientists should back off and let the politics take its course. We have left the realm of science. Basically, what's going on now is he thinks that they're trying to use this information to bring more people back to Egypt, to increase more people traveling to see these things.
Right. Right.
Now, it says that and this is talking about Wantabi. He actually is talking about his radar findings, right? This is the Japanese specialist that did all this and talks about his raw data. Says he told National Geographic website at a conference in Cairo that after more than 40 years in the field, he has customized, now get a load of this, customized his equipment to such a degree that its data is unreadable to others.
That's what he suspects.
Yeah, right? He says, when someone says they want to check the data, I'm so sad, but I trust my data completely. He says that there's no doubts in his results. But why would you change it? Why would
you change it to where nobody is doubt?
Exactly. Why would you change it? So this whole thing, both those articles, I'm so confused now. So to clarify, National Geographic did a second scan. We don't know what they found because they're not releasing it. Neither is Antiquities. But the Antiquities people are still saying it. So I don't know. Are they bound under contractual agreement? The NGS is the only thing I can think of that we're bound by Egypt's Antiquities Ministry to where they can't talk. They have a non-disclosure probably put on them. So that way, no matter what comes out, whether it was really there or it wasn't, we're not going to know about it. But it's funny that this one little story of these alleged rooms, these extra little areas there, voids in this tomb, have led to such madness in the last year. But it always seems to circle around what? Egypt. It's funny how this always seems to hinge right there.
Well, and you want my honest opinion?
Yeah.
To me, this smells of a publicist purposely leaking this information to try to get something going.
Yeah.
To stir up tourism.
That's the way it feels.
You know, how many music artists do this now where there'll be like an affair that supposedly happened or some crazy thing?
Sex tapes.
And it always happens right around the release of one of their albums, right? Yeah. It's to get it going. That's kind of what this seems like to me.
It does feel that way now. I mean, I was very hopeful that we were going to find something neat, but now it feels like something's not quite, like you're saying, it's not quite on the level. Something's going on.
Yeah, well, maybe we'll all be proven wrong and they'll find something. That would be awesome.
I hope so.
Moving on, we haven't done a DARPA report lately.
Oh,
now, this
hell.
Isn't DARPA, but close. This is from the Air Force. The U.S. Air Force is looking, they said, to fund a development of a system that allows it to easily convert any of its manned aircraft into robot-piloted planes, potentially making huge portions of its existing fleet fully autonomous. Now, according to a public solicitation notice, the drop-in system would rapidly convert a variety of traditional manned aircraft to be autonomously controlled without any modifications to the aircraft itself. Now, they say like the drone, the X-47B drone that the Navy uses, it was designed from the beginning to be, you know, humanless. What they're talking about doing is it's going to be much cheaper. They're going to create like a robot that can actually operate the gauges and operate the yoke and the throttle and can move like RoboCop inside the cabin of these jets.
I don't want to see that. That'll be terrifying.
Right? So they can drop these robots into the cockpit of existing aircraft. They don't have to build a new one. Like, say it was an F-15 that was built in 1989. They're going to build robots that'll just go drop right into that F-15 and be able to fly it. That's exactly right. Instead of having to create a whole new army of planes.
You know, that makes more sense. They're retrofitting it. That's exactly all they're doing. Right. That makes a lot more sense.
They say that a non-invasive approaches to robotically piloted aircraft using existing commercial technology and components offer the benefits of unmanned operations without the complexity and upfront cost associated with the development of new unmanned vehicles. And they say such a system will have the ability to automatically pilot an aircraft using only the gauges and cockpit controls, the same as it's available to a human pilot, and it'll save on custom design and integration cost. And they say really this isn't as shocking as it seems, because most people don't realize that most modern-day airplanes are almost fully automated at this point, and pilots barely spend any time at all actually at the controls. During an average flight, they say that, you know, pilots don't intervene. They're just there basically. This is what they're basically saying is the pilot's there to take off, and then you set like a cruising altitude mm-hmm. and set your waypoint and stuff, and then that's it. You're just there in case something happens. And then again, I guess you take it off autopilot when it's time to land. But this is coming. We've talked about it before. We were at an air show just last summer, me and the boys, and I remember me telling the kids, because they were like, man, that's awesome. I'd like to be a pilot. And I said, I know, unfortunately, I doubt you'll ever get the chance because I believe the last fighter pilot's probably already been born.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just the way it's going to go.
If you're a gamer, though, you might actually have a chance.
Well, right, yeah, right. But so we always theorize that this is happening, and it looks like it is happening.
That's going to be awesome, though. I mean, if you're looking, no, not for that, but if you're looking for the fact of saving a little money, you're going to retrofit something. But also, I mean, why not do it? If you've got all this supply, but I wonder now how much longer it's going to be to where you have those exact same robots. You're going to teach them to drive a car. You know, it just drops in. And when you're thinking of a robot, I'm thinking of basically not anything that looks humanoid-like, just like a box that it locks the controls into it, basically a box that bolts in, and then there's, you know, it's actually something mechanical as well as...
Well, you're
you
know right. I mean? When is it going to be autonomously piloted tanks, submarines, everything?
Well, I'm even thinking about Jeeps driving people around, Humvees driving them around on the base. Just like self-driving Humvees, dude, just jump in and they just take off and go.
Right.
All this, that's the next step, the way it's going. And then, of course, Skynet, and then it all takes over and it turns on us. Next thing you know, we're living on rats down in a sewer, and that's just how things work. But, I mean, what do you know? At least you got to always think about this, folks. Mr. George Dvorsky over there at Gizmodo writes about, why are you always staying up past your bedtime, Kyle? Why?
I think it's because I'm at work all day doing the tasks that I have to do. And then when I get home, I've got Little League Baseball and stuff with the family and the kids. And so finally, after about 9:30 is when everybody in the house finally goes to sleep. And of course, I'm getting tired, but I don't go to bed. No, because I need 2 or 3 hours for myself, you know, just to decompress, to watch a little TV, catch up on some sports games, read some emails, do some research, or just read a nice book. And I oftentimes look up and it's 12:30, 1 a.m. before I ever go to bed. So I am a bit of a night owl. I do like to stay up. But I think the reason I stay up is because I'm kind of forced to, because it's the only time that I have. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. What about you?
Well, it's one of those, it's I've had to relearn it. I've had to force myself almost through meditation and through different relaxation techniques so where I can unwind and go to sleep early. Because if not, I was, you know, getting about 4 hours of sleep a night for years and years. And then it just finally, when I started forcing myself to sleep, I started feeling a lot better, making myself go, you know what, this isn't important, or work harder during the day to get it all done so where I can go to bed early. This is what he says, though, on this. It says, the consequences of not getting enough sleep are evident to all of us, and yet we're constantly staying up later than what our internal biological clocks are telling us. And there's a new study that shows what's to blame. A new user-driven study published in Scientific Advances is providing a fascinating glimpse into global sleep patterns, showing that the Dutch get about an hour more sleep each night than people in Singapore or Japan. Now, the research also shows that women tend to get more sleep than men, and that the collectively variability of our sleep patterns gets smaller as we age. What's more, the study shows that social factors are preventing us from honoring our circadian rhythms, causing us to go to bed later than our internal biological clocks would like.
For sure. People are up looking at, you know, their cell phone, mm-hmm. Facebook, and stuff like that.
And now they've made it a smartphone app to study your sleep patterns.
Isn't that silly?
Yeah. Now, back in 2014, a research team led by Daniel Forger of the University of Michigan released a free smartphone app called Entrain, and his team used the data collected by this app for a current study, which is strictly related to jet lag. Now, the program is designed to help travelers get over jet lag faster. All right?
Right.
And so does by recommending these lightning schedules, basically. So installing the app, user decides whether or not that they would like to anonymously share their data with scientists. About 8% out of all of them agreed. Well, this allowed Forger's team to collect about a year's worth of sleep-related data, including, they say, a wide range of sunrises, sunsets, in relation to time spent awake or asleep. Said it's further important to point out that the researchers were not dealing with random sampling of people. Based on this method of data, the scientists were forced to deal with a group, a narrow. So this traveling group, folks that travel
right.
a lot.
Right, it's only the
right?
people that volunteered to be a part of it. Right.
And those people that travel all the time through these different time zones clearly deal with what? Sleep issues. Now, we've talked about this in athletes, specifically mixed martial arts, but we've talked about it in several other athletics. Whenever you have to travel through not just time changes, you know, we're talking about it in the playoffs, anything where the guys travel back and forth across the U.S., but imagine traveling much like the fight was in Brazil, or you may have to travel to Australia. I know it's hard on guys that travel to Australia because they're used to being asleep now in the middle of the day. They got to train. You know, your body just doesn't do the whole thing. So it can change it all up. But this is what it says. Now, according to the theoretical predictions, later sunrises and sunsets should shift wake and bedtime later, while later sunsets, boy, I am got a tongue like a yak on me, should increase sleep duration. Okay? Now,
yep.
using these models, that's how they predicted it, all this stuff, of how sunrise and sunset isolation affected sleep.
Right.
It says the effects of sunlight are weaker around bedtime than the model's prediction. This is important because bedtime is the single biggest driving factor why some sleep and not. Now, this is what he says here. We find that social pressures weaken and or conceal biological drives in the evening, leading individuals to delay their bedtime and shorten their sleep. But it's not immediately clear what these social pressures are. So they are saying that the groups of friends and stuff you run with, they do... Basically, you know, what is it? Social pressures. I'm going to stay up late. We're going to go party. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. You put these social pressures on you, but they're not sure exactly how to label these social pressures. Now, it says, though, the era of on-demand television, it says, you know, is this various forms of entertainment is also what makes people not want to go to sleep because it's that Netflix thing. You know, you hit the one season, and then the very next episode just plays, and the next episode,
yeah.
you know,
You're
you
like,
get caught
I'll just
up.
Watch one more. Yeah. I'll just watch one more. I'll just watch one more.
Yeah. Now, this is what it says. Now, like we discussed, the women tend to sleep more than men, about 30 minutes more on average. But women go to bed earlier and wake up later, and that is the trend is pronounced between the ages of 30 and 60. They also say that middle-aged men get the least amount of sleep, often getting less than recommended 7 to 8 hours. And interestingly, people who are regularly exposed to sunlight tend to go to sleep earlier and sleep longer than people who only get indoor light. Now, we've discussed this. We've talked about, you know, the lightings and stuff before. And even when Micah was on the show, when me and Micah did his show, we talked about the lighting and the way it affects people's eyes. But they showed that the major factor in sleep trends, as people get older, they tend to schedule sleep earlier, which means habits coverage as we age. So what they're talking about is people start getting what we all refer to down here in the South is setting your ways. You have your habits.
Right.
I come home, I eat at this time, I do this time. And this is what I've read. Now, I could go ahead and finish out the whole thing, and we could go through here, but it does say that the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention say that 1 in 3 adults in the U.S. aren't getting the recommended minimum of 7 hours sleep, and that sleep deprivation is a known risk factor for, you ready for this, obesity, diabetes, high blood pressure, heart disease, stroke, and stress. So sleep is something that you really, really have to have. But you start thinking about these things. When we're younger, middle-aged like that, a lot of people are either, one, working on their careers, or two, raising their families.
Right.
So you're blowing and going. You've got to, you know, there's no time for you. You're trying to get all your job done, trying to get everything done for your family, so you're the one that takes the brunt of it.
That's what I was saying. That's exactly the reason I'm staying up late.
Exactly. That's it. So when you finally have some free time to yourself, it's midnight before you have that free time.
Yeah.
So that's what it's, and then when, as they get older, well, as you get older, your families are grown. Your kids are out of the house. Your career is more solid.
So you fall back into your old ways.
You fall back into your old habits again. Yeah. So it's really nothing new. It's just neat, though, that they've got an app and these people are looking into what it is. So, folks,
get more sleep.
Try to get more sleep. Doesn't matter what it is. Try to at least maybe one night a week go, hey, look, there's nothing on TV this night, or there's nothing this, or there's nothing that. Let's turn everything off. and let's turn the TV off at 6 or whatever, and by 8 o'clock, let's all try to be in bed, and let's try to go to bed. And folks, if you're having a problem with it, go online, go get a book, anything. You can find some meditation techniques, some relaxation techniques that really do help, because that's what it had to help me, because, boy, I was the same way, as I couldn't hardly sleep. So that just, I guess, just try to get a little more sleep, folks. Just get a little more sleep, make you a little more healthy.
Yeah, exactly. Well, next up, have you ever been to Carl Shuker's website, Shuker Nature?
Yeah, it's been a while since I've bounced by there, but yes, I have.
He's got some pretty good articles and blogs over there. If you're into cryptozoology, you probably already know who Carl Shuker is. But if you don't, you should go over to Carl Shuker's website, and I'll put links to it in the show notes. He's always got interesting crypto stories, and he has a new one on there about an interesting sighting that happened in Loch Ness about 40 or 50 years ago. Pretty cool. It was actually in a newspaper over there. And this is what it says. This is the actual article from back then. It says, some 45 or 50 years ago, a small sailing vessel carrying a cargo of guano, when making the passage through Loch Ness, struck a submerged reef known as Johnny's Point and sank, fortunately without loss of life. The mishap occurred during the night, and when dawn broke, it was seen that the tops of the masts were still above water. Realizing that the vessel might be raised, a squad of men was quickly assembled on the scene, and chains were passed underneath the hull of the ship. But during their attempt to raise the ship, the craft was suddenly dislodged, and she vanished into the depths. Now, still hoping to salvage the wreck, the owner secured the services of a Mr. Duncan Macdonald, who is a noted diving expert, and who was at the time employed by the Crinan Canal. Now, Mr. Macdonald, he arrived, and he began setting up shop to go down there in his diving uniform to descend down 30 feet, they say, to see if he could, you know, if the ship could be raised. Now, after making the descent of 30 feet, Mr. Macdonald signaled that he wished to come up, and on being questioned as to whether there was any sign of the ship, he said there wasn't any. This is from the obvious darkness of the water. Apparently, Loch Ness is very dark and murky. Visibility doesn't go very far. So, of course, when he got back up and got undressed and everything, started getting out of his diving gear, well, others already knew about the stories of the Loch Ness Monster, so they started asking him, calling him out, you know, like, hey, man, did you see anything while you were down there? And at first, he didn't seem like he wanted anything to do with it. He didn't want to take part in this conversation. But they kept nagging on him, and eventually, he broke, and he said, you know what? I did see a strange creature that day. And get this. He said it lay on the ledge of a rock, and it was on a ledge, and apparently was on the same ledge that the keel of whatever this other boat was there. And he says it was about 30 feet down. He said it was a very odd-looking beast, and he said it looked like something like a huge frog. He said it just stared at him. It didn't show any ferocity or fear, so he didn't disturb it. And he said it was about the size, get this, of a goat or large male sheep. And that's it. That's the story. But, you know, Shuker goes down, he breaks down the article and talks about what he thinks it could be and things like that, and he brings it up. It sounds to me, and from Carl's writings on it, that it probably was a large catfish. What do you mean? He calls into question, the guy, he claims that the water isn't visible enough to see this ship that he's looking for, but yet he can see this cryptid animal down there perfectly. You know what I mean? How is he able to describe something that intricate with details, a goat-sized frog hanging out on the ledge underwater, but yet he can't find this ship, which they know is there.
Yeah, that does get a little smelly, don't it? You're kind of like, wait a second, what?
Well, so this brings up, you know, all the old stories of the Loch Ness Monster. Is this truly a misidentification? Now, everybody who knows is a fan of the show knows that I'm not a huge water beast cryptid fan. For whatever reason, I don't seem to like them. To me, they're just not that interesting. It's probably a large catfish. I mean, there's freshwater lakes near where me and Cam live right now, and I know that divers, I've spoken to people, I said that they've seen catfish down there that are ginormous. Definitely the size of a goat.
Yeah, definitely goat size. Exactly, right? Yeah.
So, I mean, couldn't it have been just a crazy catfish?
Not an actual monster? Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, well, that's what it seems like it is. So, anyways, very interesting. Let's take a break, folks. And when we get back from the break, I'm going to get into this story. It was recommended by a listener of ours, Chris Kearns, over in Scotland. And it's a very interesting story about the Flannan Isles and a mysterious disappearance of three lighthouse keepers. Stick around, folks. You're listening to Expanded Perspectives.
For some strange reason, lighthouses not only safely guide ships past treacherous rocks and dangerous shorelines, but they seem to attract stories. It's not clear why this happens. Is it their isolation, their oddity, or the relationship with fog, stormy seas, lost ocean-going souls, or actual shipwrecks themselves? It seems almost every lighthouse in the world has some sort of creepy story associated with it. For some reason, most revolve around hauntings, ghost ships, and even sea monsters. The difference with the lighthouse on the wild Flannan Islands in the northwest part of Scotland is that its eerie story is true. Just over a century ago, something peculiar really did happen. A disappearance, which remains one of the most mysterious ever recorded in Britain. In December 1900, three lighthouse keepers, Thomas Marshall, James Ducat, and Donald MacArthur, were on a lonely outcrop of the Flannan Isles. They each disappeared without a trace. No answers to their disappearance has ever been found, and for over 100 years now, this case has been one of endless fascination to those who love unsolved mysteries. Something about the mystery of these three men, isolated at the edge of the world, surrounded by the hostile Atlantic Ocean, gets under your skin. The Flannan Isles, also known as the Seven Hunters, are named after a 7th century Irish priest called St. Flannan. Apart from the 70 years when the lighthouse was manned, the windswept islands have always largely been uninhabited. The only other structure on the islands, apart from the lighthouse, is a tiny ruined chapel dedicated to St. Flannan. The islands were always viewed with great superstition. By the Hebrideans, and although they used the island to graze sheep, they believed it was unlucky to spend a night there. The Flannan Isles Lighthouse was built in 1899 on the tallest of 7 rocky islands, on an island known as Ailing Moor. It is situated 15 miles west of the Outer Hebrides. It took 4 years, and building and construction work was continually hampered by the difficulties of safely landing supplies on the island because of the very common stormy seas of the wild Atlantic Ocean. The lighthouse first went into operation on the 7th of December, 1899. It had no wired or wireless communication in those days, and its only form of communication to the outside world was a series of semaphore-style balls on a post, which could be seen by the Hebrides on a good day. For 10 years, the lighthouse was happily staffed by a 3-man crew, which rotated every 2 weeks. On the 7th of December, 1900, head keeper James Ducat arrived at the lighthouse to commence another 2-week shift. His first assistant, Thomas Marshall, and his second assistant, Donald MacArthur, also joined him. Temporarily alongside them was Robert Muirhead. He was the superintendent of all the lighthouses in that area. Robert Muirhead's job was to check and make sure everything was okay and operating flawlessly at the lighthouse and on the island. This occasion was no different. After his technical inspections were over, Muirhead chatted with the three keepers and discussed various improvements. Then, he climbed aboard the relief vessel and set off for Lewis Island, leaving the lighthouse in safe hands, or so he thought. Now at that time, he didn't know it, but Robert Muirhead was the last person to see any of the keepers alive. Soon after Muirhead's visit, an unusual tenacious mist rolled in from the cold Atlantic. The sea fog totally enveloped the island and, of course, the lighthouse. Now, fog is a common occurrence in this area of the world, but something was different about this fog. It was some of the thickest, most dense fog ever recorded. If the dense fog wasn't enough, a very strong squall blew in, and the seas began raging. Viewing the lighthouse was not only made difficult by the heavy fog, but the mist from all the crashing waves caused by the winter storm made visibility nearly impossible during the day from nearby Lewis Island. Thankfully, the light from the lamp on the lighthouse was much easier to make out during the night, which is the time of day when ships need it the most. The lamp was visible, for instance, on the evening of December 7th, but was later obscured by severe weather on the following four evenings. It was seen again on the 12th of December. Then, another 2 weeks passed with no confirmed sighting. All this was worrying, but not so unusual as to cause panic. But then, on the 15th of December, the steamship, the SS Archaeor, was sailing in the vicinity of the Flannan Isles. Just before midnight, Captain Holman looked out from the deck of his steamer, expecting to see the reassuring flash of the Flannan Isles light, so near that no fog could obscure it. There was no light. Still, this didn't cause any alarm or panic. After all, the relief vessel from the Lewis Island would be arriving at Flannan Island on the 21st. As it happened, another savage run of weather blew in and delayed this vessel, the SS Hesperus, for another 5 days. As the Hesperus finally approached the tumbling seas around Flannan, the captain looked out. Now, what would normally happen on such occasions was that a flag would be flown from the lighthouse to show the incoming boat that they had been spotted by the keepers. Then, the lighthouse crew would come out onto the rocks, ready to help the men from the Hesperus, who would manfully row to the island in a dinghy. This time, no one was there. Watching from the Hesperus, Captain Harvey saw no flag and no sign of men living on the island. He gave orders to blow the steam whistle, but it was met with only silence. There was now little choice. Something was definitely going on. Two seamen, Joseph Moore and Jim McCormick, climbed from the Hesperus onto a dinghy and rowed ashore. As McCormick lashed the dinghy to the harbor rings, Moore went up to check on the station. With a rising sense, something was very wrong. Everyone has experienced something like this on their own personal lives. You just somehow know something isn't right. You can feel it in your bones. The outer door to the lighthouse was locked, but of course, Moore had a set of keys. So he opened the door for himself, and as he scanned the scene inside, it became obvious that the place was deserted. There was no signs of anyone. Oddly, the clock on the wall had stopped. There was no fire in the freezing grate. A meal had been prepared, but was uneaten. Upstairs, all of the beds were empty. Inside the lighthouse, nothing looked out of order. The lamps were each trimmed, the beds were made, as if the men had gotten up, cleaned the whole lighthouse, and secured all the equipment. The stove was checked, and the ashes inside were cold. This meant there hasn't been a fire in there for a few days. There also was a chair overturned in the center of the kitchen. A closer inspection revealed that there were two sets of outdoor gear missing, and only one set of oilskins remained, which meant that one of the three men had gone out without his protective weather gear on. This is something that would be completely impractical. For all three men to leave the lighthouse unattended at the same time went against all the rules laid down by the Northern Lighthouse Board. The only set of outdoor clothing which remained belonged to Donald MacArthur. So much myth and folklore has grown up over the Flannan Isles mystery that some have reported that when Joseph Moore first opened the main door, that three strange birds flew out. And as the lighthouse tower was searched, odd strands of seaweed were found on the stairs and in the little cubbyhole where the lighthouse logbook was kept. But no one knows if this part of the tale is true or merely urban legend. Now, alarmed at what he had seen, Moore hurried back to the Hesperus, where he explained to his captain and crew that the three men were nowhere to be found. He explained to the captain that they looked everywhere. They searched every room. They searched everywhere. And there were no signs of the men. It was as if they were there and then just gone. He explained that the uneaten meal was prepared and was left, the overturned chair in the center of the kitchen, and the article of clothing that was left behind. The captain decided to do a more thorough search, this time of the entire island. They even went into some of the booming sea caves along the shoreline. They found nothing. The original three-man unit of lighthouse keepers had inexplicably vanished. Now at a loss, the Hesperus sailed back to Lewis Island. There, a telegram was sent to the Northern Lighthouse Commissioners, informing them of the strange and odd disappearance. Meanwhile, on Flannan Island, the remaining crew from the Hesperus left to tend the abandoned lighthouse, where they began conducting an even more thorough and painstaking search. At the west landing stage, they found extraordinary damage. Iron railings were bent out of shape, and the iron railway by the path was completely wrenched out of the concrete. Their only conclusion was that the damage had been caused during one of the terrible storms. As the search continued, an eerie picture of events began to emerge. It seemed that everything had been running smoothly on the island up to a certain point. The headkeeper's log showed that there had been a mighty storm on the 14th of December, a storm that by the next morning had blown itself out. That's where the log ended. Whatever had happened to the three men, it must have started after the afternoon on the 15th. On the 29th, Superintendent Muirhead sailed from Lewis Island to the fateful Flannans to make an official investigation. His report is the most detailed account from the state of the island at the time. Robert Muirhead's conclusions were tragic but simple in nature. He theorized that the Great Atlantic Storm on the night of the 14th of December had clearly caused substantial damage. The jetty was bent out of shape and the railings were battered. So powerful where the waves and surges, great rocks, had been dislodged and hurled about, and the ropes had become snarled on a temporary crane a full 70 feet above sea level. Now confronted with this new evidence, Muirhead therefore concluded that all three men had left the lighthouse in order to secure the station's equipment following the terrible storm. One by one, they had taken waterproof oilskins and boots from the lighthouse. Muirhead knew this because the kit was missing. The last one had apparently locked the outer door behind him. Then, Muirhead believed, an unexpectedly large wave had crashed over the top of them. The wild Atlantic had swept all three men to their deaths. Now, this is only a theory, and many people don't agree with Muirhead's theory. And since the event, many questions have been raised. There were serious oddities in the story, such as the discovery of an unused set of oilskins, which indicated that one of the men went out of the lighthouse without any protective clothing. Why? Why would he do that? At least two of the men didn't. Why on earth did any of them lock the door when they left? Furthermore, these natural explanations for the disaster ran contrary to a rigid lighthouse-keeping rule. This insisted that one man always stay in the lighthouse to guard the lamp at all cost. It was unheard of for this rule to be broken, yet it apparently was. Finally, there was the storm. Even the logbook said that the keepers had calmly waited out the terrible storm. Yet, the meal had been left uneaten on the counter, as if someone had rushed out. And if the storm had blown itself out, why were they wearing their oilskins? The whole thing was very confusing, more confusing than Muirhead's report indicated. Perhaps Muirhead had a reason for being quiet about the story. Trinity House didn't want rumors of weirdness putting off any replacement keepers. There were enough who had already been freaked out by the events on Flannan Island. And as we talked earlier, lots of people believed that it was unlucky to spend the night on the island. Of those men on the Hesperus who landed on Flannan Island that spooky day, several decided to take emergency leave. Several more retired. They were so unsettled by what they had seen and the strangeness of the Flannan disappearance that most of them quit. So what really happened on the Flannan Islands that day? Since the vanishing, many competing theories have sprung up. Some say that the men were kidnapped by slavers or pirates. Others say that a sea monster dragged the trio into a watery grave. And there is even a theory that claims that all three men were abducted by aliens. Of course, the problem with all these theories is the lack of any evidence. But there is one sinister and unsettling theory that does hold. Believe it or not, there's a history of lighthouses driving lighthouse keepers mad. Let's take a look at some of those other stories. The first one is that of the Solva Lighthouse in Pembrokeshire, Wales. This is a classic example. This small lighthouse was completed in 1776. In 1780, one of the keepers, Thomas Griffith, died during a storm. Because the other keeper did not want to be suspected of murder, he hung the body of his colleague outside of the house rather than hurling it into the sea. Perhaps unsurprisingly, the sight of a bloodied cadaver swinging outside of the window every morning had a strange effect on the other keeper, Thomas Howell. He became severely distressed. However, he could not be taken off the lighthouse for 2 whole months because of bad weather. When the authorities finally sent relief, the new keepers found Howell running around the lighthouse in a frenzy. He had gone completely mad. There are other similar horrors that occurred on the St. Simons Lighthouse in Georgia, United States. According to a local newspaper, in the 1880s, the keeper and assistant keeper had been together for several weeks. One evening, they began fighting over a chicken supper. Eventually, the assistant became so incensed that he murdered his colleague. Like poor Thomas Howell, this assistant had to be taken from his lighthouse in a straitjacket, although he later recovered and confessed to the murder. And what about the Little Ross Lighthouse in Scotland? In August 1960, two keepers were stationed on the island, Hugh Clark, a former postman from Dowry, and Robert Dickinson, a 24-year-old ex-sailor. A few weeks after the keepers were both installed, Clark's body was found by a passerby in the lighthouse. It was riddled with rifle wounds. Dixon was nowhere to be seen. However, a nationwide hunt tracked him down to Yorkshire, where he was later arrested. Months later, Robert Dixon was charged with the murder of Hugh Clark. He was found guilty and sentenced to hang 4 days before Christmas. In the event, Dixon was reprieved, but he slit his own throat in jail, apparently driven insane by the horrors of his own crime. The reason for the murder was never fully established. Perhaps there wasn't one. Finally, there's a notorious tale from Australia. In the early 1950s, Herbert Yates and girlfriend Rita arrived at remote Tasman Isle Lighthouse. The isolation quickly got to the Yates, and he was transformed from a relatively normal young man into a drunken monster that constantly menaced his young partner. The woman's terror was heightened by Yates. He had a formidable arsenal of weapons at this point, including knives and a marksman's rifle. Then, a young assistant, Bob Tregenza, arrived at the remote outpost. He protected Rita, and the two began a passionate but clandestine affair. Eventually, the inevitable happened. Yates discovered the pair in an embrace, and he killed them both in cold blood with the butcher knives before turning the gun on himself. All in all, the history of lighthouses is a tapestry of madness and murder. So, taking into account these stories, what can we say really happened on the Flannan Isles those stormy days in the year 1900? For weeks, the Flannans had experienced unusual isolation and confinement during the Great Storm. This was followed by long days of a deep and dense fog, cutting the lighthouse off from all contact. It is far from inconceivable that this intense isolation tipped one of the keepers into psychosis. If one man did run amok, his lunacy might have led to the deaths of the others in various ways. Maybe he tried to kill the second member, and when the third crewman intervened, they all ended up in the sea. Maybe he stabbed the others to death and then dumped their bodies over a cliff. And then he locked the door for a final time before hurling himself off the rocks. It's a chilling and bizarre image, but it does answer the questions better than any of the crazy other theories. It also bears an image that somehow fits the dangerous world of the Flannan Isles. Even today, if you go to this place, it has a deathly atmosphere. It's cold and dark and dreary. When you watch the seabirds wheel against the leaden sky around a lonely and very deserted lighthouse, it's not difficult to experience a shudder of dread or despair.
And we're back with Expanded Perspectives. Very interesting story. No one knows what happens to the three lighthouse keepers. They were there one day. Some storms came in, some massive amounts of fog. They were stranded. You got to remember, this is a time back 1900 before there was any wireless communication or anything like that. So literally, if you're on a small outcropped island, you know what I mean? And there's bad weather, you can't get to them.
But the lighthouse is the ultimate wireless communication.
Right? With the light.
With the light.
And so when they get there, all the guys are missing. They don't know what happened. They don't know if it was foul play, if somebody was killed somebody.
Bum, bum, ba, bum, burr.
Yeah, they're all, and so it's mysterious. And now I know there are the theories, and I touched on them briefly, about some people say that aliens abducted them. You know, this is the thing that gets me annoyed. Same thing when I watch Ancient Aliens. Why is it always got to be aliens? Somebody goes missing, oh, aliens got them.
Yeah.
It kind of is, it is annoying because the field of ufology is a real field, and I generally am interested in UFO sightings, alien abduction, everything like that. I am interested in that. But it's stories like this. Every time something happens, somebody blames it on aliens. That's the problem with it. It's like, why does it have to be that?
It's harder to be taken, any kind of study like that, taken serious whenever that's what everybody wants to, you know, instantly, because it's an old, like we've talked about with the Dyatlov Pass, because it's an old story that's what you want to instantly label it as. We're like, well, let's not just jump to going, oh, well.
It had to be Yeti
with your Giorgio Tsoukalos hair. Oh, well, it's aliens. I didn't hear the question, but the answer is aliens.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Sounds like to me there was something going on. A rope or something was tangled around a crane, and a rogue giant wave, probably hit them and washed them over off the pier or wherever they're at. And you know, you can't swim good in rough water like that. And
cold.
Yeah, very cold. And they probably just drowned. You know.
Yeah, hypothermia is quick and not good.
Yeah, very. Yeah. Odd, but you said you had something odd about, we may not even need men anymore.
Yeah, the ladies are going to love this story right here. This comes from National Geographic News also. It says, well, who needs males? Their self-cloning females actually heal faster. That's a North American lady, salamanders. They have evolved a way to keep its all-female lineage going over time. Now get a load of this. They don't just survive, but they thrive. Now there's a type of salamander, the ambystoma salamander in northeastern North America, and they don't need the males to reproduce. They clone themselves generation after generation. It's a situation that many scientists believe is a dead end, since the lack of fresh genes from males could eventually make the females weaker, but that's not what this new study is showing. There's a scientific team, and they focused on this ability of this salamander to lose part of its tail, right? We've talked about this, and how it quickly regenerates this missing appendage when it gets talked to. We're always like, man, that'd be awesome if we could do that. Well, scientists observe the rate at which all female ambystoma salamanders regrow their tails with that of these other species, both male and female, and they found the unisexual species regenerated its new tail 1.5 times faster.
That's awesome.
Right? Now, Rob Denton is an evolutionary biologist at Ohio State University. He says that there's lots of interest in regeneration. This is his quote, but we don't know how diverse the ability is, so our findings are important for sounding the alarm that this ability is far more complex than we thought. They talk about stealing DNA. Now, these self-cloning salamanders evolved more than what they say 6 million years ago. But it didn't, of course, he goes on to say that the lineage wouldn't have survived so long if it didn't have some sort of benefit, this lifestyle of what they call of stealing this DNA. This is one clue about this unisexual salamander to steal the DNA from the sperm of other salamander species left lying around. So instead of using that DNA to fertilize their eggs, the all-lady salamanders simply add it to their own genomes. They kind of absorb that part of the DNA, right. You know, as wild as it is. Now, it says this means that some females don't have two copies of their chromosomes like most animals, but three or even four. Many times, the extra genome copies aren't even of their own species. Now, Catherine Greenwald, she's an evolutionary biologist at Eastern Michigan University, and she studies these salamanders. And here's what's funny. She calls herself the Maury Povich of salamanders because she says her work involves figuring out which species contribute genes to the complicated, diverse jumble that is the unisexual ambystoma genome. So basically, it's going on. It's talking about how they grow it back, how fast it can do, how they pull all these genomes. And I could go into all this stuff because they give you a pile of stuff. But Maureen Nealman is an evolutionary biologist at the University of Iowa, and she led the regeneration research on the asexual snails. Now, apparently people have been studying this for all of this, and she says it's a really powerful and cool experiment that they're comparing a trait about who wins in a natural setting, and this doesn't happen a lot in studies. So it's going off the fact that there's a limitation to this study that Greenwald and Nealman both point out, and that the researchers didn't compare the regeneration rates of unisexual salamanders with those of which they share a genome. That makes it more difficult to determine whether the regrowth differences were due to the asexual reproduction or the number of genome copies or some innate differences, it says, in the rate of genome copying. But what she says is it's a great first step, that the number of copies of a genome and one of our most fundamental traits, and we still don't know why so many species have settled on two copies. So basically what they're saying is these salamanders don't need to breed. They can absorb these different genomes, so they're not reading a bottleneck, which is you would think would happen. If they're cloning themselves, sooner or later you would think if something bad goes along, they're going to hit a bottleneck sooner or later. They're saying this doesn't happen because they share more than just two copies. They have three, four copies of these genome sequences, so they don't. It's almost like a new father every time it lays down in there. So what they're saying is the females don't even need a male to continue their lineage going. But ladies, don't get discouraged and don't get carried away. You got to have us guys around. Who's going to open y'all's pickle jars?
Right.
Who's going to help? Who's going to open the door for you? Who's going to pull out your car?
Who's going to take the trash out?
Who are you going to yell at whenever somebody's feet's up on something it shouldn't be on?
Right.
Yeah. So don't get discouraged yet. We know y'all still need us around. It's fine. It's cool. It's all good. Well, they may not need us around. But anyway, so don't go getting all unisexual salamander on us, ladies, you know, because we like you ladies, too.
Yeah, very, very cool, man. That's neat. I'm glad to be back. And people, if you're not aware, we do an extra show every week called Expanded Perspectives Elite. And recently, Cam was doing one on what I think is one of the craziest stories of all time, the homunculus.
Yeah,
if you're not an elite member, you need to go check that out. Also, the last episode, we were talking about the Spear of Destiny. And I believe on this Thursday, you're also going to be continuing the story of the Spear of Destiny. And so if you don't want to miss out, you go to the website, expandedperspectives.com, sign up. For $5 a month, you'll get an extra episode every single Thursday or Friday. And also access to our entire back catalog. I think it's around 100 episodes there.
We're already getting in on it right now.
So if you're a fan of Expanded Perspectives and you're only listening to the free shows, you're only listening to half our work. So you should really go over there. If you'd like to call the show, you can call us 817-945-3828, or you can email us. You can email the show at expandedperspectives@yahoo.com. For all you elite members, we'll speak to you on Thursday. For everybody else, please get some more sleep. Take care of each other. Give somebody a hug. And of course, stay out of trouble. I'm Kyle Filson, and he's Cam Hale.
Peace, y'all.